All right, welcome to First Baptist Church. Let's all stand up and sing this morning. You are worthy of my praise.
And I will worship with all of my heart. And I will praise you with all of my strength. And I will seek you all of my days. And I will follow
you alone. are worthy. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You know, we, one of these days, church, we're going to get it. It's not about us. It's all about Him. You know, and there's so many times in life that we just get that close. We just, like old Moses, we get a glimpse, but we just don't enter in. And you know, when He says, you alone are worthy, you alone. And so when we come into the house of God, let us come with that focus in mind. It's you. Father, today, everything else that's going on outside, but today, you alone are worthy. You alone today, I've came to worship. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We thank you so much for the blessings of this day. Father God, we just come this morning and just confessing so much that's in our lives that we know that's unpleasing unto you. And Father, our desire today is to be right in your sight. And Father, I realize the only way that happens is through the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And He alone is worthy of my praise. So Father God, just touch our hearts, touch our minds, touch us today in a way that you've not touched us in a long, long time. Lord, draw us under your throne. Lord, draw us under yourself.
So this coming Friday night is the Bonfire Beauties. It's a night for all the ladies to get together. That starts at 7 p.m. on Friday evening. If you want to be a part of that, there's some of these flyers out there. If you want to take a look at them, take that home for a note. This will be you were either handed one or there are some out on the Welcome Center. And we also appreciate all the help, everyone that showed up this past Friday night. We had the homecoming celebration, the fifth quarter after the homecoming game this past Friday. Had a lot of teenagers, a lot of help from many of you. Thank you for coming out, adults, and putting it together and helping so much. Also, look in the bulletin for the ladies' Bible study. There's a couple opportunities for you there, and Miss Pam has something to say. Oh, okay. All right, we're going to take it out of your pay then. New study. Okay, so Stronger is over, and they're going to start a new one. Next Tuesday. So this particular Tuesday, the morning ladies Bible study is taking off. And then this Tuesday evening, you'll have opportunity to go over if you want to be a part of the evening study that's over at Farmington. There's a BSF Bible study fellowship. If you want to be a part of that, ladies, you can hitch a ride with Miss Cindy Brown, maybe. She's going to go over there, and some others also. So other announcements we might have missed. All right, I have Miss Naomi's going to come up and share something with you.
I just want everybody to keep remembering Operation Christmas Child. We were going to try and come up and say something about it every few Sundays so people won't forget, but I was one of them that was fortunate enough to get to go with the Operation Kickoff down in Fredericktown. And we heard a lot of good speakers there talking about things that go on over in these third world countries. And it just breaks your heart to know what some of those children go through. And we have a box over at the hospital. I had asked the hospital administration if we could put a box up. So if you're out sometime and pick up something and the church is not open and you don't have a place to take it, we'll bring it over there and put it in the box, and we'll take care of it, make sure it gets here. Thank you.
All right, let's have the ushers and deacon come to have the reading of our scripture and the receiving of the offering. Miss Judy. Right, exactly, mid-November. So somewhere around the 19th or so, we will be collecting those.
My name's DJ Stiegel. I'll be reading from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. Are you anxious or upset about something today? Let's see what God's word says. Rejoice in the Lord always. I say again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. We just pray that you would allow us to follow your word and to give you our petitions and our concerns and our anxiousness and our petty things that are going on in our lives, and just give us a bigger perspective that we can see that we're here on earth to do your will and to be used by you to bring others to Christ. We pray that you would bless these tithes and offerings and just bless this church and help us to be about your business, Lord. And we ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Scott. Thank you. All right, let's all stand up and sing again this morning. Let's praise our Lord. We want to see Jesus lifted high this morning.
want to see. We want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see Jesus lifted high. Step by step, we're moving forward. Little by little, we're taking ground. Every prayer, a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down. We want to see Jesus lifted high. Banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know He is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted high. We want to see Jesus lifted high. Step by step, we're moving forward. Little by little, we're taking ground. Every prayer, a powerful weapon. Strongholds come tumbling down and down and down and down. We want to see Jesus lifted high. Banner that flies across this land. That all men might see the truth and know He is the way to heaven. We want to see Jesus lifted high. 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 Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Your love makes me sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain, burn beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. our God, and all will see how great. Our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God.
Lord, we just come before you today, praising you, Lord. Just lifting you up, Lord, that you can be that banner before all men, Lord. How great is our God today. As the pastor said earlier, it's not about us. It's about you, Lord. It's about you. It's not about us looking out at everyone else. It's about us looking inward to ourselves to see you. Lord, let that be our prayer today, that in all that we do, that we see you in us. How great is our God. Lord, we just thank you so much that you are such a great and awesome God, that you reach down to each and every single one. Can find you anytime. You are there, Lord, every time. Lord, as we have the word that comes today, Lord, just let our eyes, our ears, and our heart be open to all that comes before us today, Lord. That when we walk out these doors, that we see you in us, but that others see you through us as well, Lord, in all that we do. We ask everything that happens today, we ask it all be according to your will today. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Children may be dismissed for children's worship at this time.
Good morning to you again. If you have a Bible with you this morning, turn with me to the book of Matthew. It'd all work out better, wouldn't it? Sometimes it's just nerves, I guess. And then we got another guest in our service today. You want to introduce our guest, Miss Carol? Mom is in the house. Huh? You just do what you got to do. Me now? Me now. I'm on. Ryan had me turned off and Carol turned me off. So anyway, so. Book of Matthew, chapter 7. And once you get there, I'll get find it. I'm in Mark. And it don't look nothing like what I prepared, so we'd be in all kinds of trouble. Matthew chapter 7 and verse 1. You know, I have been going to church my whole life. And I've heard some messages that are like no other messages. I've had to sit and listen to some great preachers. And a lot of those preachers have been my former pastors. And I could always tell, if I'd been there for a while, I could always tell when something was kind of getting to them. And I thought to myself, you know, they kind of acted like a dog that couldn't get to that place to scratch, all right? And sometimes we kind of get that way as pastors. You know, Nicodemus, we preach in Nicodemus in John chapter 3. And we teach John chapter 3, and we teach it there in John 3 and 3. And you must see, if you want to see the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. John 3:16, for God so loved the world. John 3:17, he didn't come into this world to condemn this world. This world was condemned already. And see, the thing is we get so spiritual sometimes that we forget what practicality is. If you read in the book of John and go back to when Nicodemus introduced himself to Christ and approached Christ, he said this. He said, I know that you're a teacher sent from God. A teacher. Many people, when they got around Christ, they called him teacher. The reason being is because Jesus' ministry was about teaching his apostles. Jesus' ministry was there, and you say there, well, Jesus' ministry came, and the scripture tells us this, that Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. Amen. But Jesus came to equip those, because he would tell Peter later on, he said, I'm leaving. And you're going to be the one, and the apostles are going to be the one that's going to carry out this ministry that I have started. And church, that's who we are today. We are the called out that are called out to carry on the ministry. And so when Jesus was teaching there, and sometimes what we look at is we say, well, let's go to all of those. And when Jesus would speak of the parables and speak of the leaving the 99 to go get the one, let's talk about those salvation messages. Let's talk about building upon the rock of Christ. But in the book of Matthew, chapter 7, Jesus had as they were assembled, Jesus began to teach them. And you know what I see is in my life, and maybe just a little bit in yours, I don't know if it's that way or not. Sometimes it would be that if church was like school, many of us would be held back in certain subjects. Because what we find is there's some things that we excel at. I remember when we get report cards, and report cards was always a kind of a stressful time after my freshman year in high school, because that's when sports took over, and I didn't think that academics had that much importance. And so what happened was, is I remember when report time would come, and I'd get all anxious, and I'd get my report card, and I take it home. But you know one thing I never worried about? I never worried about P.E. And I always got the A in P.E. Then come to find out, the teacher, the only reason they gave you A in P.E. is because you dressed out every day. So it really wasn't that tough anyway. But there was other areas that I did not excel in. In church, there's some things in this church that we excel in greatly. We are a church that has a love for people that, you know, that come across sometimes things that they didn't plan. And we have the ability to reach out and show the love of Christ in some amazing ways. And you know, and many a times when that situation happens, those people come to me. And they come to me and they tell me, they say, you know, Pastor, there's nobody like your church. Your church is so special. Your church. And boy, I tell you what, I take a little dose of humility, and then I take a big drink of pride, and I think, yep, that's my church. And then there's other times when people will come to the pastor, and it's amazing the thing that reaches the pastor's desk. And when he comes there, and the people will tell me some things that have gone on and things that are going on in the church, and I look at him, I said, you know what, I really don't know who you're talking about. Surely that's not. And that's where Jesus was in the book of Matthew. He was beginning to lead, and it was his apostles there and is in his teachings. And what he was sharing them with is, you know what? I'm going to fill you with my spirit. And he made this promise to them. You remember what he told them there? He said, don't leave Jerusalem until the promised one or the Holy Spirit comes upon you. And Peter, I'm going to tell you something. I've got a message prepared for you that's going to turn the world upside down. But until you preach and teach that message, I've got some principles that I need you to learn. And these are very important principles that we shall learn. And if we don't grasp them, what we're going to find is we're just going to become, as the Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, unless I have love, I am as a tinkling cymbal. So it does not make no difference what songs we sing, how loud the pastor preaches, unless it's done with the love of Christ, then what we're going to find is we're going to find that all we've done is we just begin to tinkle and we begin to clang. Read with me in the book of Matthew in Matthew chapter 7. Pastor's not mad either. I want you to know that. Do not judge so that you will not be judged. For in the way you judge, you will be judged, and by your standard of measure, I will measure you. Why do you look at the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, and behold the log that is in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Let's jump down to verse 12. In everything, therefore, treat people the same way you want them to treat you, for this is the law of the prophets. Some very good reading that we see here. And as Jesus is speaking here, and I would imagine as they begin to gather, and what do you think the expectation would be? The expectation would be that now Jesus' notoriety had come to a point there, and then when they sat there and they would listen to him, and as they would listen to him, they thought, what is it that he will share with us today? What a miracle will he show us today? What lame man will be healed? What blinded eyes will be touched? And the anticipation was there, and in Matthew it says, he begins to teach them principles of the Christian walk. Now, when we read these things and we see these things, they probably first thing begin to do is they begin to look around. I remember one time I was at a church service and pastor started preaching this sermon, and I knew something that was going on in some old boy's life that was in the church service with us. And right away I thought, boy, the preacher's nailing him today. Boy, this one's definitely for him. Sometimes what we need to do let me share you the end of that story is simply this. Before the sermon was done, I was the one at the altars, not him. And sometimes the things that we say is the outfielder, as the ball was hit to the outfield, and one hollered, I got it. And the other one said, no, I got it. And today I just pray that you would just let the Lord open you. And then many times when we think something's for somebody else, maybe it's for us. But the first thing that Jesus says to them, he said, why is it? Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye, but not to notice the log that is in your own eye? You know, I read over in Galatians this week in chapter 5, and I'm going to share in just a moment. Galatians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul was speaking about the fruits of the flesh and the fruits of the Spirit. And as he was speaking there, I thought about that. I looked back in Matthew, and sometimes what we think is, as the called out, God has many times what he has put is in our armies, we have infantry. In our armies, we have pilots. We have those that, you know, snipers, whatever you want to call them. But you know, the thing is, Pastor, God called me out to be an MP. I'm a military policeman. I'm a Christian policeman. And what God called me to do is kind of police what goes in the congregation. And if I see somebody doing something that's not right, God called me to point it out. God called me and said, you know, simply there, he said, you know what? There's a problem there, and I'm going to be the first one to call it out. And Jesus said, why is it that you look at the speck in your brother's eye, the small thing in your brother's eye, but you pay no attention to yourself? No attention to yourself. Many times in our life, what we do is it's amazing in our Christian walk. We read all the passages and all the scriptures about his patience and his long-suffering, his forgiveness and his compassion. But many a times we read that, but we never share it. I want to share something with you. If you see a brother stumbling, and you do see a brother with a speck in his own eye, minister to that individual. Just minister to him. But Jesus said, what you do is here you have this plank or this log in your own eye. You know, it was probably about 15 years ago when I reached spiritual perfection. I think it was on a Saturday night, wasn't it, Merle? No, I don't even know if it was last night. I told Sister Roseanne when we came into church this morning, I said, Miss Roseanne, this is a message today. This is a message today that everybody could go home and I could preach, and I believe the one that God meant it for would hear the message today. Because what Jesus was saying here is simply this is, opportunities of ministry come all the time. Opportunities to minister, opportunities to reach out. But what we are too busy doing is we're trying to find the fault in others. And you know what? When I find the fault in others happen, Sam, it makes me feel just a little bit better. You know, I tell you what, my life is not what God would have my life to be. But you know, when I look at old brother so-and-so, I ain't that bad. You know, when I look at sister so-and-so, you know, maybe I'm just a little bit better than what I thought I was. And so here it comes, and Jesus said there, he said, why are you doing this? 1 Corinthians chapter 11, he says, let every man learn to examine his own self. I told Kinsey a while ago, I love talking to Kinsey because Kinsey agrees with everything I say to my face. But I told her, I said, Kinsey, you know, the thing that we do and we do and we do and we do, you know, is we're just all about everybody else. I told her this, and this is getting straight up with you. I know when my life is not where it ought to be in God's sight. You say, how do you know that? Because I begin to battle everyone else around me. What I begin to do is I think to myself, Lord, you know what? And there was a country music singer that sung it a long time ago, and I don't know what the rest of the song was, but he said, misery loves company. Misery loves company. Jesus said there simply this, when you got a log in your own eye, just learn how to deal with it. And friend, I want to share something with you today. If there's something that you're battling with, if something there that you're battling with, the Lord says, take care of it. Now read with me in the book of Galatians chapter 5 and verse 17. I love this Paul's writings here, but he said, if I say walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desire of the flesh. For the flesh sets itself against the desires of the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. For the flesh sets its desires against the Spirit. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. For the deeds of the flesh are, what did Paul say here? Paul said the deeds of the flesh are evident. Now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, outburst of anger, disputes, dissensions, and factions. Envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these, which I forewarn you, just as I forewarned you, that those who practice such a thing will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now here's what we like to do. What we are all about is simply this, is I'm a sports fan, and I've told you guys that. I check the MLB power rankings every week. Is that not silly? What a silly thing to check. Like it really means something. But the Cardinals still are number one 7 weeks in a row, if anybody cares. Blue Jays moved to number two, Pirates, and then the Cubs. And you know, and I just go down the line there and see, you know, what they are. And so what we do is just chronologicalize everything, you know, just set everything in order. See, the amazing thing is simply this, is the battle of my flesh. What I do is I like to put it in order and said, well, Paul, if I look at this right, then you're saying the worst one about all of them is simply this, is immorality, impurity, sensuality. That's your top 25 list. But friend, I want to share something. What we do as many times as we look and we say, you know what? Sin in my life is not near as bad as the sin in your life. But friend, what I want to share with you today is sin. And the sin in your life has a direct effect on you, just like the sin in my life has a direct effect on me. But he said these things are evident. These things are evident. But then he said, look at this, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh with their passions and desires. And if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Let us not become boastful, challenging one another. Let us not become boastful, and challenging one another and envying one another. Brother, if anyone is caught in a sin, any kind of trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking for yourself, so that you too will not be tempted. Learn how to bear one another's burdens. Therefore, fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But each one must examine his own work, and then he will have reason. Then he will have reason for boasting to regard to himself alone and not in regard to another. For each one will bear his own load. You know, the writings of the Apostle Paul are some of the most amazing writings in all the Scripture. And we read them, and when we read those, we say, well, Pastor, now you're going to remember, that wasn't Paul. That was the inspired word, and I grasp that, and I get that. But Paul, many a times, as he spoke in the book of Romans, and he spoke about the love of God that, you know, and there was no condemnation for those who are in Christ. He spoke about the things that nothing would ever separate us from the love of God. He would talk about the wages of sin, but he would also talk about the gift of God, that is eternal life through Jesus Christ, his Son. But as Paul was speaking to the church in Galatia, he said, you know what? Church, here is your opportunity. Here's your opportunity. You've got a log in your eye. You got something there, you know, in your flesh and spirit. Friend, I pray with it, you deal with it. You deal with it. And you say, well, Pastor, I don't know. Well, I'll tell you what, whatever you're battling, whatever you're dealing with, look in Galatians chapter 5, and you find out where you're at. Sam, I've never battled with gentleness. I've never battled with love. I've never battled with tenderness of heart. It's not a battle. But I have dealt with immorality. I have dealt with being quick to anger. I have dealt with self, and I've dealt with those things. And when I begin to deal with those things, and Leather and I, Merrill and I were sitting at a house, and I think it must have been seventh inning stretch, because I remember the game was on. Great thing is my wife loves the Cardinals, watching them about as much as I do. But we begin to share some things and talk about some things. And church, I want to share this with you. This don't cost you nothing. Your pastor has a love for you like you don't know. But your pastor's wife has the same love for you. And when the battles are on, what I want you to know is we don't sit there and think to ourselves, you know, let's figure out how to show this person. What we try to do is find ourselves in a place there and said, Lord, first of all, just search us and know us. And Lord, after that, then Lord, with gentleness of spirit, kindness, tenderness of heart, let me go to that one that also is struggling. And Jesus says that. Once you deal with yours, then go help him. And then as he drops down, he said, learn how to do to others as you would also have them do to yourself. You know, I just find myself trying to remember what my brother Byerman always told me. He said, Pastor, when you get done, always be at the cross. So I can't finish until I tell you something. Those that beat upon him, those that spat upon him, those that cursed him, those that mocked him. Just as he hung upon that cross, he spread his arms open wide and he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. When I think about all that Christ went through, and I thought about all that I have put him through, and he still loves me. And 1 John says this, I cannot say today that I love God who I have not seen and hate my brother who I have seen. He said, if I say that, he said, I'm a liar and the truth is not in me. Paul would say in Galatians chapter 6, if one amongst you stumbles, go restore that one. Because you know why? Someday that could be you. All these passages, all these scriptures, Pastor, where's the spirituality? Let us today look at the practicality. And as we look at the practicality, we'll see the spirituality. In other words, simply this, my flesh is a battle. My spirit desires that the person of Christ would be magnified. The plank that is in my eye is not pleasing. But Lord, I forgive me for those trespasses and help me to reach out to that one that I have targeted, to reach out to that one that I have saw fault in, and let me help also restore them into a right relationship with you. Bow your heads with me, please. Father God, we come to you today. We just thank you for the blessings of this day. Father, we just thank you for your word, and we thank you for the truths of your word. And Father, we just thank you that your word does show us. Your word convicts us. Your word causes us to do a self-examination. And Father, but your word also calls us to a different walk. So Father God, today, the sin that is in my life, the plank that is in my eye, Lord, today I just bring it all to you. Not that I can stand and proclaim, look at me, but that I can reach out to my brother and sister and said, let me help you, show you how you can experience the same forgiveness that I myself have already experienced. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand with me, please. You need to come. You come.
I'm giving you my heart and all that is within. I lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. I'm giving you my dreams. I'm laying down my rights. I'm giving up my pride for the promise of new life. And I surrender all to you, all to you. And I surrender all to you. All this world holds dear, I count it all as loss for the sake of knowing you, for the glory of your name, to know the lasting joy, even sharing in your pain. And I surrender. Giving up my pride for the promise of new life.